singing, born of this nation of white bread foundation. We're taping a king beating off his crown. My country tears of the sweet land of irony, spoonful of sugar to wash it.
And welcome to another episode of Culture Wars Radio. As always, I am joined by my lovely and talented co-host, Dan Ray.
How you doing, buddy?
I'm doing okay. Up to my eyeballs in cooking at the moment.
Is that right? What are we cooking? Do tell.
I'm doing a pig roast this weekend.
Oh, you are?
Yeah, we're having our CFI Michigan retreat on Saturday.
Okay.
For the first time, we're doing a whole pig.
Roasting an entire pig, eh? Yeah,
not a big one. That's a small one, about a 70-pounder. So
that's a good-sized pig, my friend.
Yeah, that's considered sort of a suckling pig. So anyway, we don't want to talk about that and bore my listeners. Okay. But yeah, I've kind of upped my eyeballs in food right now. So
okay,
as I usually am, you know, to be honest, barbecue, you know.
Right.
So this week, I wrote a thing on my blog on Saturday or Sunday, where I said history is about to repeat itself. What we saw a couple of weeks ago when Trump went to the G7 summit and then went and met with Kim Jong-un was he goes to the G7 summit, he insults the hell out of our closest allies, and then goes and sings the praises of this dictator thug. And I said, we're going to see the exact same thing this week, because he's going to the NATO meeting and then he's going to this private meeting with Vladimir Putin. And sure enough,
you're psychic. You know,
they're 5 or 6 hours ahead of us. So I wake up on Monday morning and he's already done it. It's like 8 o'clock Monday morning. He's already insulted our closest allies, lied about them multiple times. And it wasn't, they weren't even through breakfast yet.
Yeah. And I have to ask, and I realize there probably is no answer to the question, but to what end? What is Trump's end game here? Does he have an end game? And if he does, what might it be?
I tend to assume always that he doesn't have an end game.
Right.
Because I think the key to understanding Trump is that it's not about policy, it's about personality.
Correct.
It's about striking a pose. It's about being the tough guy and the bully. It's about his ego, that almost everything he does can be explained that way.
Yep.
That's sort of my starting point. Now, that may be once in a while, that may not be true. Once in a while, one of his strategists may have come up with this thing and talked him into it, where there is a sort of a strategic purpose to it. But I think as a general rule, that's a pretty safe assumption.
It seemed to me from the get-go, as soon as I saw what he did at breakfast the other day, that this is simply another instance of Donnie doing what Donnie does, which is dick-waving, trying to impress his favorite constituents, the idiots who put him into office, and at the same time, to show his buddy Vlad what a bad guy he can be too. See, I can be just as tough as you. That's what it is.
I think that's a plausible explanation. But let's also be clear about what he did here. So, first of all, he lied multiple times about Germany and energy production. He claimed that they were captive and controlled by Russia.
Right.
Because they've signed a deal for a pipeline to bring more natural gas to Germany for energy production. Now, by that reasoning, we are captive to Canada and Mexico, from whom we import about 25% of our oil, right? They must control us.
To say nothing of the oil that we import from the Middle East.
Yes. So, which we don't actually import all that much, but people don't really know that. But Canada and Mexico are our two biggest oil importers. That's where we get most of it from. And so they must control us, right?
By absolutely.
Quote unquote reasoning. And I'm doing air quotes on a radio show.
Yes.
With my fingers. And he said that 65 to 70% of the energy in Germany comes from Russia. It's actually 13% that they get from natural gas total, and Russia supplies the bulk of that. He said that they had shut down their coal and nuclear plants, which is a lie. They have not.
Right.
Now, they have a goal of doing that by 2030, but to replace it primarily with solar energy, with natural gas as a backup. Germany leads the world in solar energy. They have done a tremendous job. There have been many days in which they have fulfilled their entire national energy needs just through solar generation, which is amazing, and we should be following their lead on this.
I agree.
So he lies in their face about them. He insults them. He claims that they owe us $40 billion, which they don't. And like you said, to what end? What do you like? Even if you take the positions that he's taking, that they should be upping their defense spending so we don't have to spend as much, that's not a totally unreasonable position to take. The Obama administration urged them to do that and actually got an agreement for all the countries of NATO to boost their defense spending to 2% of GDP by 2024.
Yeah, other administrations have done that, but they have done so in appropriate diplomatic ways, right, as you say.
Right.
Negotiating through diplomatic channels and diplomatic back channels to achieve mutual agreement. That's fine.
Exactly. Quiet diplomacy. That's how you do this, especially when you're dealing with your closest allies.
Correct.
You don't embarrass them in public. You don't lie about them. You deal with them as equals. It just...
As the president of the EU so aptly noted, we really need to spend more time being nice to our allies because we don't have that many of them left.
Well, he is making sure we're having fewer and fewer of them.
Yeah, that's right.
And the look on I'm one of those people that tends to think, don't make too much out of a picture. Because you can take a picture that says almost anything.
I know exactly which picture you're talking about.
But at that breakfast, the look on the faces of John Kelly and Mike Pompeo and Kay Bailey Hutchinson, at what point does someone in the Trump administration, some high-ranking official like one of those three, in the middle of one of those kinds of situations, just stand up and say, I can't do this anymore, enough?
Good question. To say nothing of the NATO folks who were sitting across the table. You saw the looks on their faces too, right?
Yeah.
How did they not simply stand up and say, we didn't sign up for this kind of nonsense. We're not going to sit here and listen to your ignorance. We're out. At what point does something like that happen?
I would have stood up and applauded. I would have given them the longest standing ovation on either side.
Correct.
For someone to just stand up and say, enough.
You are a moron, and you are destroying this country.
And we are not going to take it anymore.
Well, sadly, none of the people sitting at the table with Trump, not Hutchinson, not Pompeo, not Bolton, none of them are the least bit inclined to do anything like that, I'm afraid.
Well, John Kelly is the guy that I think is probably most likely to do it, but here's the problem. He's active duty.
He doesn't get court-martialed.
We've had several ambassadors who have resigned and written public letters saying, I just can't be a part of this.
Right.
But I mean a cabinet official. I mean somebody way up there, a Jeff Sessions. That would be a powerful message if Jeff Sessions just came out and said, I've had enough.
It really is to our everlasting shame that this is the person who is representing us to the world,
It is. I have been embarrassed by many things that our country has done in terms of foreign policy, supporting dictators and human rights violations and unjust wars and all of that.
Sure.
But at no point have I been just embarrassed by our leader and just said, I don't want that guy. I mean, George W. Bush wasn't my favorite president by any means. But there was, he came from a family that had a long history of public service.
He was a professional politician.
Yes,
I think that that's an important distinction to draw here. And it's one that I've drawn many times before. I agree with you. George W. Bush was a strikingly incompetent president, but he nevertheless was a professional politician. He knew how to handle people in his own party. He knew how to handle people of the opposing party. And most importantly, he knew how to behave diplomatically. Donald Trump isn't a professional politician. Donald Trump is a carnival barker and a con artist and a showman. That's it.
I forget who it was that said, what we've done is we've elected the comments section on a Fox News article.
That's it. That's exactly right.
It's accurate and frightening. And It's just,
and the more outrageous, the better, you know, I mean, the more offensive, the more outrageous, the more the people who voted him into office are going to stand there and applaud and say, boy, doesn't he tell it like it is? I'll tell you what, that's my president.
I think that's true of about 80% of them. I mean, he's already lost a portion of the people who voted for him. You know, according to the approval ratings, you know.
Right.
But yeah, there's a core of about 30%, 32% maybe, that you're right. It, I mean, when he said he could shoot somebody on Park Avenue and get away with it, he was not. That was not a joke.
And that's a big number, by the way, 30 to 32%.
Yes, it is.
Of the electorate. That is a big number. That's a lot of idiots.
Yes. So the next topic I wanted to discuss is not sort of directly tied to the news, except that we now, of course, have a new nominee for the Supreme Court.
Right.
Kavanaugh, he's a conservative, presumably an originalist.
Is he really? Is he a conservative, Ed? Really? I hadn't noticed.
Although there's some really like super far right conservatives.
I know. Yeah. Scary, isn't it?
Who think that he's like not conservative enough.
He's a squish. Yeah.
Yeah.
Can you imagine? How far right do you have to be
exactly.
to look at Kavanaugh and go, that guy's a flaming liberal?
Right. So we want to talk about, do sort of a tutorial, a symposium on the subject of originalism. But I want to start one level above that with, there are sort of two basic schools of thought when it comes to interpreting a constitution, legal formalism and legal realism. And this is obviously Dan's subject of expertise, so I want him to explain the difference between those two sort of basic frameworks.
Sure. And we should point out that really what we're talking about here is a whole lot of fancy stuff that is rooted in notions of textual interpretation and textual understanding. So we're going to talk about originalism in all of its forms, and we're going to talk about some theories that maybe compete with originalism in some sense. But the idea behind all of this is really the same, and that is, here's a text. What does it mean? How do we arrive at a, if not a correct meaning, because there usually isn't, or there may not be, one single correct meaning for a text, how do we arrive at a range of acceptable meanings that we can then pick from based upon different factors? So that's what we're after here. We're trying to understand the meaning of a text. When Ed speaks of formalism versus realism, he's abstracting this debate or raising it one level, if you will, above textualism or originalism. And we're now speaking more broadly of what it means when we say the law. If you are a legal formalist, then you tend to believe that the law is something of a discrete entity. It stands on its own in the sense that it can be separated from other types of thought. It can be separated, most notably, from, say, politics. There's something of a dividing line between law and everything else if you're a legal formalist. And your goal is to keep the law pure. You don't want to contaminate the law or legal thinking, legal understanding, legal reasoning with something that isn't the law. But if you are a legal realist, then you tend to say, no, I don't buy that. I don't think that the law, whatever it may be, is hermetically sealed off from everything else, and that when we're talking about the law, we can separate the two. So, for example, you might believe that law and economics are inextricably intertwined. You might believe that law is simply an extension or a continuation of politics, politics by another means, if you will. So that's sort of the basic theoretical divide between legal formalists and legal realists. Have I covered it enough, or is there something else you want me to do?
I think that's fine, but I'll also point out that sort of as a very broad Venn diagram,
yes,
legal formalism tends to lend itself to conservative views of jurisprudence, and legal realism tends to lend itself to liberal views of jurisprudence.
As we understand those things today, I would agree with that. Yes, there is not a necessary political valence to formalists versus realists. There's not a necessary leaning one way or the other. But the way we practice it today, that's the yes, you're absolutely right.
Okay, so let's start by looking at the various forms of conservative originalism. Because originalism as a form of legal formalism, well, first of all, define originalism sort of broadly.
Yes. Originalism simply means that we're going to look backwards in time to what some other group of people understood this particular text to mean. And there are lots and lots of different ways that we can do that, as we will see. But the idea behind originalism is that the people who created this, or the people who were around when this was created, would have had a better understanding of what the law was supposed to be, what it was supposed to do, what it was supposed to accomplish than we do today. So, the thinking goes, we ought to defer to those understandings. That's originalism in a nutshell.
Right. So, originalism can take various forms.
Yep.
Conservative originalism, there are three primary ones. There's original intent, which is what did the people who actually wrote it intend for it to do?
Sure.
There is original public meaning, which is what did the people who ratified the Constitution think it was supposed to do?
Right.
And there is original expected application, which is how would the founding generation have implemented. So you look at practices at the time, like, for example, if you were to try to figure out what constitutes cruel and unusual punishment in the Eighth Amendment, you would go back and look at the application at the time, what was actually done at the time. Well, at the time, they had stocks,
right,
and public floggings. So clearly, as it was expected to be applied by the founding generation, they did not look at that as cruel and unusual, but as normal practice.
Right.
That would be an example of how you would use original expected application to determine meaning of a text. Now,
and so if you were an originalist who adhered to the original expected application view, then I think it's safe to say you are going to be more likely to tolerate what we today would consider to be extreme forms of punishment, right?
Right, except, of course, Justice Scalia. Justice Scalia very famously gave a lecture on this, that very subject, and said, this is one area where I would consider that to be cruel and unusual punishment, and I would not apply my originalist framework in that instance based on the actual practice at the time.
To be fair, Scalia described himself as something of a faint-hearted originalist.
Right. Which, that was actually the title of that talk.
Yes, that's right. Yeah. That's right.
But that does raise this question of the difference between originalism and theory versus originalism in practice. And they can be vastly different.
No question.
Because, well, for a number of reasons. But, you know, one is that I truly believe that no matter how much they pretend that originalism is just this sort of formulaic thing, you just plug the data in the top and out pops the right answer at the bottom. And as much as they pretend that they are just reading the law and they don't allow political considerations or philosophy or religious or any other considerations to color their view, that's just nonsense. Of course, they're human beings.
It's convenient, isn't it, that the most evangelistic originalists will say, I believe in this 110% and I'm committed to it. And it's purely coincidence that the outcomes that happen to be achieved overlap almost perfectly with their own personal policy preferences. Isn't that amazing? I've always found that to be absolutely astonishing.
And that's not always true, to be fair. I mean, there have been instances where they have, you know, Texas v. Johnson, the flag burning case, where Justice Scalia said, no, this is protected speech. I don't think anybody should do it. I hate the idea. But it is right. Protected political expression. Right. And I'm not going to allow, there are instances where they do apply it fairly, but there are lots of instances where they don't.
Yeah, I'll take the don't on that one more often than the do.
Here's a perfect example I've used many times when I write about this. Loving v. Virginia.
Yeah.
The interracial marriage case overturned all state laws against miscegenation or interracial marriage. And that's a case where if you're going to apply originalism, that ruling had to be wrong. Period. Yeah.
Correct.
Because the men who framed it, the men who wrote that that amendment, and the way they explained it to the public, because there was big concern at the time, the public didn't want to vote for that, the 14th
right.
Amendment.
Right.
If it overturned state laws against interracial marriage. This was post 1868. You know, we may have overturned slavery, but racism was horrible. And every white person, it seemed, hated the idea of interracial marriage. And they said, no, don't worry. The Equal Protection Clause does not overturn state laws against interracial marriage. It has nothing to do with it. They can't be used that way, we promise. So the original intent, the original public meaning, the original expected application all say you can't use the Equal Protection Clause to overturn interracial marriage bans.
Right.
What did the court do in 1967? They used the Equal Protection Clause to overturn interracial marriage bans.
Well, here's an even more glaring example. How about Brown against Board of Education? Yeah. Do you honestly think for even a nanosecond that anybody who favored Brown against Board of Education really thought seriously that integrated public schools would be the order of the day under the 14th Amendment? I mean, the same Congress that passed the 14th Amendment created a system of segregated public schools in the District of Columbia. So trying to fit the round peg of Brown against Board of Education into the square hole of originalism is an absolute exercise in futility. There's no way.
But here's the thing. They can't say that.
Of course not.
Politically, it'll kill them.
Right.
If you nominated somebody for the Supreme Court who was a dyed-in-the-wool originalist, a Justice Scalia, and you said, do you think that Brown versus Board of Education or Loving versus Virginia were correctly decided? Every single one of them is going to say yes.
That's right.
Because they know, first of all, that those opinions are considered now so sacrosanct that nobody, to the left of David Duke, can afford politically to be against them.
And so they twist themselves into knots trying to figure out how to justify Brown against Board of Education under their supposed originalist views, you know?
Yeah. The pretzels they will bend their jurisprudence into.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Incredible to listen to.
Now, to be fair, I should say this. You know, we're sitting here and we're slamming on originalism. There is an argument, and we will, I'm sure, sort of talk about this a bit more later when we talk about more liberal versions of originalism. But there is an argument to be made under the 14th Amendment that if you want to abstract at a high enough level, then you can say, all right, things like interracial marriage and integrated public schools aren't completely out of bounds. And the idea is simply that the 14th Amendment, like so much of the Constitution, was aspirational. We were aspiring towards full equality for all persons, regardless of ethnicity, regardless of skin color, and so on and so forth. So, I mean, if you want to play that kind of a rhetorical game and you want to abstract at a sufficiently general level, you can come up with arguments that will sort of fit that round peg into that square hole.
Right. But you can only do it by contradicting what you already said about originalism.
Correct. That's right.
So that's really, I think, the point that we're trying to make. So again, the difference between originalism in theory versus originalism in practice is an important one. Now, we should also say that while originalism as broadly maps to conservative jurisprudence, liberals use it too. I mean, look at the dissent in Heller versus D.C., the gun case. It's all about originalism. It's all about what did the Founding Fathers mean when they said well-regulated militia, et cetera, et cetera. So the point is that it's that originalism is not in and of itself invalid. And I hear a lot of liberals who react to it simply because it tends to map to conservative politics, reject it as a ruse or a myth or something that just shouldn't have any role at all in interpreting the Constitution. And that seems to be foolish to me.
Well, I agree with you. But here's I suppose at some point I'm going to have to do this, Ed. So, you know, should I do it now? Do you want me to crawl up on my originalism soapbox now, or do you want me to wait until some point later on? I get the arguments, and I understand the place of formal legal interpretive methods, and I get the arguments that are in favor of originalism. But I got to tell you, I think it's a bunch. As originalism is practiced today by its strongest conservative evangelists, originalism is nothing but a bunch of bullshit that's sold by a bunch of bullshit artists. If you don't believe me, then take a look at Scalia's concurrence in Raich, which is laughable if you are trying to claim that under the mantle of originalism.
That. I know what you're talking about, but explain what case you're talking about.
Yeah, Raich against Gonzalez, the compassionate use law, the medical marijuana law. And the issue is regulation of medical marijuana under the Commerce Clause and whether that's appropriate or not. And Scalia basically ties himself into knots trying to demonstrate why it's appropriate for the federal government in the guise of the Controlled Substances Act to regulate all uses of marijuana under the Necessary and Proper Clause. Well, I mean, it really was kind of a laughable mess. Same thing with his opinion in the Heller case, the gun control case, the Second Amendment case. For someone, if you're an originalist, to basically ignore the entire Second Amendment prefatory clause, to read it out of existence, is hardly consistent with originalist principles. And then, of course, what we've already talked about, the endless parade of Republican GOP nominees to Article III seats who have to appear before the Senate Judiciary Committee and explain why they think Brown against Board of Education was correctly decided and why Loving against Virginia was correctly decided at the same time that they pretend to be originalists. So that's my first complaint, if you will. My second complaint is kind of goes to the point that you were just making, and that is that originalism as a species of formalism has sort of been used to hijack the terms of our interpretive constitutional debate. We have come now to this belief, mistaken though I think it is, that the only legitimate way to interpret the constitutional text is some form of originalism, that everything else is simply legal realism, and that it is more or less to some degree illegitimate. And so it's been used to sort of hijack the terms of the debate in bad faith. And it's frankly, it's become effective. And that's why we now have self-described liberals who are sort of playing on the originalist court. They're trying to redefine the terms of originalist rhetoric and swing it more towards the liberal or progressive view. And then I suppose last, but certainly not least, is this. Originalism, simply, when I think about it, doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me. Does it? Should we consider ourselves bound by the original public meaning or the original expected application of constitutional principles as they were understood in a fledgling nation state, one that operated with very, very clear, very well-established, ruthlessly enforced legal, political, and civil hierarchies that favored white male property owners in an 18th century agrarian economy that quite often, frankly, was simply broke or very near it. Unless the goal is, as I've said before, unless your goal is to return us to that kind of a society, I just don't know that originalism makes a whole lot of sense.
I guess I would take a little more moderate position than that. I would say this, that a legal realist ought to just look at originalism as one of the many tools in a toolkit.
Correct. And I agree with you. Let me be clear. I don't mean to suggest that that originalism as an interpretive modality is entirely inappropriate or illegitimate. It's not. It is one tool in the interpretive toolkit, period. That's it. It has no more or less legitimacy than any other of the interpretive tools that Article III judges rely upon every day.
And as a as an attorney might say, it's evidence, but it's not dispositive. It doesn't settle the matter.
Right. That's right.
And one of the reasons why it doesn't often settle the matter is because, contrary to the pretenses of conservative originalists, it's usually just not that easy to figure it out. And sometimes there are conflicts. The example I always use is the Establishment Clause.
Right.
Did the Establishment Clause forbid the federal government from issuing days, declarations of days of thanksgiving and prayer, for example?
Right.
Well, take the first four presidents. George Washington said, no, it didn't. John Adams said, no, it didn't. Jefferson said, yes, it did. Madison said, yes, it did. Which one is the right originalist interpretation?
There you go.
You know, again, you have to pick and choose which one of these. Now, at that point, I think that's where you start to bring considerations other than legal and textual considerations into it. You say, okay, we have these two legitimate interpretations, two different interpretations that are both, can be tied to the founders themselves. Which one are we going to choose? Well, first of all, we ought to look at the fact that we are a far more religiously diverse society today than we were then. That matters a lot.
Sure.
If you're going to pick and choose between those two. So that's where you start to bring in sociology. You start to bring in demographics.
Right.
So that these other considerations, this is where, like you said, you can't hermetically seal the law off from everything else that's going on in society.
Right.
Ignore the fact that we are a different society today, as you said, in massive, unthinkable ways.
Right.
What would have been unthinkable 225 years ago.
And we should note at some point during this conversation that most judges and most legal scholars recognize that these various forms of originalism are simply what we've described them to be, which is one tool in the interpretive toolbox. What are the competing types of interpretive modalities that get used every day? Well, in addition to text, which is what originalism is all about, there are things like structure and history and precedent and consequences. And those, I think, are just the names are probably fairly self-explanatory. But you can quite easily see how sometimes the text of the Constitution doesn't yield any clear answers. What does it mean when we say that no state shall deny to any person within its jurisdiction the equal protection of the law? That simply is an indeterminate text. Unlike, for example, that part of the Constitution that says if you want to be the president, you've got to be 35 years old. Okay, that's easy enough. But there are more of the equal protection types of things in the Constitution than there are the 35-year-old age requirement for the presidency. So simply looking to the text alone is not always going to answer your question. You need to look to the structure of the Constitution. You need to look to history. You need to look to precedent, how it's been applied in the past. You need to look to consequences, what kinds of good or bad things may result.
And what you mentioned precedent, and this is kind of I want to take a parenthetical aside here because we have this upcoming nomination fight.
Yes.
This drives me absolutely batty. When, you know, they're going to try to ask him about, you know, are you going to overturn Roe v. Wade? And his answer is going to be, you know, Senator, I have a healthy respect for precedent.
Yes.
I think that judges should take precedent seriously, blah, blah, blah. Everyone is in favor of following precedent
until
they're
not
in favor of following precedent.
There you go.
It's
absolutely
it's just
right.
One of those where it's just such a mealy-mouthed non-answer, and we let them get away with it.
Right.
And there's no rule on this. There's nothing in the Constitution that says you can't ask a nominee if a past decision was correctly decided or not.
Right.
It's just, you can ask them, and we let them get away with these just non-answers where they're just babbling. You've said nothing.
Well, Kavanaugh's been a bit more clear. He's made it clear that as far as he's concerned, stare decisis, respect the decision, let the decision stand, is a good idea. But he has said, and this may not be an exact quote, but it's close. He said, it is not an inexorable command. Translation, right. I'll stick to the prior precedent when it suits me, but don't expect me to do it all the time if it doesn't.
Well, I mean, here's the thing. He's right. That's how
right.
You actually look at
exactly.
Stare decisis.
But that's
right?
The way every judge looks at it. Every
exactly.
Judge looks at it that way.
Right. They make it sound, and then when you go back to like John Roberts' confirmation, and, you know, I just call balls and strikes. And you
yeah.
Just go, oh, come on.
What
come
a joke.
Come on. Who believes that?
Right.
It's like, these nomination fights have become this weird kabuki theater, right?
Yep.
Where pre-rehearsed questions, pre-rehearsed answers, everybody pretends they're being very serious and very rigorous in examining the record of this. And that has nothing to do with it. Nobody says anything of substance. You know, the one guy during the Roberts and Alito confirmation, that were, you know, the last ones that we had during the Bush administration, the one senator on the Judiciary Committee that was actually asking really interesting, direct questions and demanding answers was, what's his name, from Minnesota that he resigned, the comedian.
Oh, Al Franken. He
Al
was
Franken.
Great. He
was not
great.
In the movie.
Yep.
But
yep.
By God, he had done his homework.
He had a hell of a staff, didn't he? And they
he
did their homework and they had
about,
him prepped. Yep.
Yeah.
They
he
had
what he
him
was
prepped.
Talking about, and he was asking very direct questions. And that was the point at which I went, wow, this guy's not a joke.
This,
he could have gone to the Senate and been a joke, and he wasn't.
Al Franken had it going on, you know. But I'll tell you, you know, look, the process has just become so rehearsed and so. So bastardized that it really is essentially meaningless anymore. You know, you can expect nothing but a few days of softballs from the GOP senators. You can expect direct, hard-hitting questions from the Democrats, most of which won't get straight answers. And at the end of the entire process, you're not going to know a whole lot more about Brett Kavanaugh, if anything, than you do right now.
Yep. It's all about politics. They're going to fight it because that's, you know, that's, and they should. It should be about politics. Admit it. That's fine.
Yep. That's right.
I don't have a problem with that. But this pretense that you're asking tough questions and they're really, you know, it just drives me batty. I can hardly watch them anymore. So, okay. So enough about conservative originalism. Most people don't realize that there are non-conservative versions of originalism out there. And this gets really kind of into the weeds of con law, the kind of stuff that you and I get all excited about, and most people probably
right
falling asleep at. But there's two versions that I want to talk about. One of them has been called liberal originalism, and it was invented by a law professor at Georgetown named Randy Barnett. And it's not liberal originalism. It's really libertarian originalism.
Yeah, and you probably know more about this one than I do. I haven't followed this one that closely.
Yeah, so Barnett is a libertarian, and a very good legal scholar, very, you know, excellent writer, and you know, a good thinker. The focus of liberal originalism really, it seems to be mostly on the Commerce Clause.
Right.
And reversing that. And I'm there, you could probably give some background on this, but basically the Barnett's libertarian liberal originalism wants to turn the clock all the way back and reverse the New Deal.
Right.
And really back to, you know, the proponents of that tend to look at the post-Civil War amendments, 14th in particular, and say that was where federal power really exploded.
Right.
So we need to go back to that point because they want to reverse that and basically make it so the states are mostly independent again. 90% of the laws at the state level, not the federal level. You know, the libertarian utopia, basically. So,
Well, and I think you're beginning to describe quite aptly why it is that I haven't followed it that closely, and I'm not much of a fan of it. I think to the extent that I think conservative originalism is bullshit, I think this is bullshit on steroids.
Yeah, this is far worse in some ways. There was a point at which it sort of appealed to me, and there's a part of it that appeals to me in that Barnett was the one who came up with this idea of the presumption of liberty, and he wrote a book called The Presumption of Liberty, which focused a lot on the Ninth Amendment and this idea of unenumerated rights, which is something that I've written about a lot, and it's really the way you and I kind of met, was in these debates over that back in 2005, something like that.
Right. Way back when.
In the early days of my blog, when I got involved in some of these discussions among legal scholars, particularly the Ninth Amendment and the Establishment Clause. And on the Ninth Amendment, I'm a big fan of the Ninth Amendment. I think that the conservative position, whenever you hear conservatives say, well, the Constitution doesn't say you have a right to do that, my response is, so what? Doesn't say you had a right to do a lot of things that you have a right to do, you know?
Right.
And so Barnett was the one who came up with this idea of the presumption of liberty, which is that you are presumed to have the right to do something until the government can show that you should not.
Right.
And that's an argument that I find very compelling. That's a position that I find really an important one, and I wish the courts would apply it more. But I think their focus on federal power and the Commerce Clause is really dangerous.
Well, look, here's what gets Barnett's motor running. And there's a little something to it, but I don't think that there's anywhere near as much to it as he might have us believe. So the idea of the Commerce Clause is that Congress ought to be able to regulate matters of commerce where the states are, for whatever the reason, incompetent or unwilling to do so.
If the commerce is interstate,
if the commerce is interstate, and I should be clear, when I say states are incompetent or unwilling to do so, that's one of the things I'm including. Look, the Supreme Court's Commerce Clause jurisprudence has grown up in a fairly clear fashion. There are three categories of things that Congress can regulate that touch on interstate commerce. The first is what are called channels of interstate commerce. Think roads, highways, airways, airwaves, anything over or through which interstate commerce might travel. Congress can regulate it. Or as I used to tell my students in class, the simple way to remember it is if it crosses a state line, the regulation is fine. The second thing that Congress can regulate under the Commerce Clause are what are called instrumentalities of interstate commerce. These are the persons and the things that move over, across, or through the channels of interstate commerce. Persons and things that are moving in interstate commerce. And by the way, that includes persons or things moving in interstate commerce, even if the movement where it's being regulated is entirely intra, I-N-T-R-A, within a single state. third category of things that Congress can regulate pursuant to its commerce power, and this is the one that gets Barnett going. Local activities that, here come the magic words, substantially affect interstate commerce. These are the kinds of things that allow Congress to regulate all kinds of intra-state activities, and it drives people like Barnett nuts because they say, wait a minute, these are, by definition, local activities. They're not moving in interstate commerce necessarily. They may have some attachment to interstate commerce, hence the substantially affect interstate commerce, but we are talking about things that are local. So when, if you want to know what it is that Barnett really gets worked up about, that's the thing. It's the third category of stuff that Congress regulates pursuant to its commerce. So
the case that came from, and I'm forgetting the name of the case, but I remember the details of it, that it involved
Wickard against Filburn.
Right. It involves a farmer growing wheat.
Farmer Filburn.
Right. And the federal government had standards. I'm fishing for the right word now, but quotas.
The Agricultural Adjustment Act gave farmers, commodity farmers and growers, quotas that they were allowed to produce. So Farmer Filburn produced something like 237 bushels in excess of his allotment of wheat. His argument was, look, I grew this extra 237 bushels not to introduce it into the stream of commerce. I'm never going to sell this to anybody. I'm going to keep it and I'm going to use it on my own farm. I'm going to use some of it to plant next year's crop. I'm going to use some of it to feed my cows and my other livestock. And whatever's left over, I'm going to give to Mrs. Farmer Filburn to make us wheat bread. And that's it. Well, in doing that, he violated the provisions of the Agricultural Adjustment Act, and he got busted for it.
Right. And the argument the court made, the ruling was, that even if you aren't going to sell this, even if you're not using it for commerce, the fact that you grew it means you don't have to buy it from somebody else.
That's correct.
And therein now you have affected commerce.
That's right. That is correct. Even though what we're talking about is a local activity, right? The raising and production of wheat and the consumption of that wheat wholly on your own Farmer Filburn farm, if you add together all of the Farmer Filburns everywhere in the country, and all of them produce 237 bushels of wheat to hold back so that they, like you, don't have to enter the interstate market in order to satisfy their needs, then we have a substantial effect on interstate commerce, the argument goes, and thus Congress ought to be able to regulate that kind of wheat production. Makes sense to me.
Yeah, and it's one of those where it's easy to feel sympathy for Filburn, right?
Sure,
it's easy to go,
of course.
Yeah, why is the government telling you that you can't grow to make your own damn bread? I get the sort of impetus for the opposition there, but regardless, this was what, 1937,
something like that. Yeah, right.
That case was decided. So, I mean, if you're going to have respect precedent, we're done, right? I mean, no, nobody's going back and overturning that.
Right.
Clarence Thomas probably would.
Yeah, that's right.
But, you know, he'd go back and do the slaughterhouse cases from the 1870s, too.
That's right.
But so that was really the beginning of, and here we're talking about levels of abstraction, really.
Yes.
How much are you willing to abstract the text, the meaning of the text, and abstract the authority given to Congress to regulate interstate commerce. And here again, from a legal realist perspective, you say, look, we can't seal this off from other considerations. We are a very different society today than we were in 1787 when the Constitution was passed.
Right.
Back then, there hardly was any farmers' commerce. It was, you know, you might sell a little bit to your neighbors because you grew something they didn't.
Right.
But for the most part, your farm was to feed your family.
The Commerce Clause didn't become a thing until the late 19th century. It really was a dead letter until then.
Right. And so, you know, if you're going to look at sort of, look, society just isn't the same. And so this text and these authorities and these frameworks, the structure here has to be able to adapt to modern realities. And that brings us to the other form of originalism that I am partial to, which is referred to as living originalism. And there is a book by that name. This idea was created by a law professor at Yale named Jack Balkin, who was your con law professor.
Not at Yale, but yes. And actually, he wasn't my con law professor. He was my criminal law professor, but he taught me constitutional law. In 45 minutes, he taught me constitutional law.
And Balkin, you know, brilliant legal scholar. Right?
Oh, smartest guy I have ever known. Scary smart.
So living originalism is a form of something called framework originalism. And you have a different name for this. Sort of explain what his general theory is.
Yeah, Balkin's idea is that Balkin is the one who taught me way back when that this idea of originalism isn't necessarily moored to any particular political valence or view. It's as we talked about earlier, it's been co-opted more or less by the right today, but they don't have an exclusive license to use it. And Balkin got tired of arguing the formalist-realist debate by always having to take the realist side. And again, we talked about how the sort of the terms of the debate have been hijacked, and he fell for it for a long time. And then finally, you know, about, I don't know what it was, 10 years ago, 15 years ago, he said, the heck with it. There's no reason why I can't come up with a liberal form of originalism and call it whatever I want. So I call it the theory of text and principle. The idea, we kind of talked about this a little bit earlier. The idea is that you don't focus so much on the literal verbatim text that you find in the Constitution, because, not because we don't want to understand what it means, but because the text by itself is likely to be rather indeterminate. Instead, what Balkin says is we need to look for the principle or the principles that underlie the constitutional language that we're trying to understand. So, just to take one example that we touched on earlier, the Equal Protection Clause of the 14th Amendment. No state shall make any law that deprives to any person within its jurisdiction the equal protection of the laws. Okay, what does that mean? Well, good luck figuring that out. But Balkin says, why don't we instead focus on what he and others have come to call the equality principle? There was an aspirational goal that motivated the people who created and enacted the 14th Amendment way back when, and that aspirational principle, the equality principle, stood for the idea that what we really wanted was a society where everyone could be seen as equal before the law, regardless of where you come from, regardless of what your skin color looks like, regardless of what religion you practice or don't. None of that matters. We are all equal persons before the law. Once we can accept that equality principle, that underlying principle behind the 14th Amendment text, then we can start to put some flesh on the bones and figure out what the text itself is intended to do and what it's supposed to accomplish. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I think so. And I really should have started maybe one level above this again.
Okay.
Because part of this, I mentioned this is a form of framework originalism, which really gets to this idea of constitutional legitimacy. And that's the first part of his book is dedicated to this idea of answering this question. Why should we in 2018 be beholden to a text that was written 230 years ago by people in a vastly different society?
Right, exactly.
You know, and all of that. So that's a, that is sort of the central question of constitutional law, right? Why should we follow a written constitution? We didn't sign it. I was just born here. I didn't have anything to do with it, right?
Right. Correct. And, and that's Dawkins, one of the arguments.
Dawkins' answer to that is that the Constitution is legitimate because it provides a framework within which we can adjudicate these disputes.
Yes.
And that framework involves the structure of the Constitution in that you have democratic institutions like the House of Representatives, and now the Senate, which was originally not a democratic institution. You have non-democratic institutions like the judiciary, independent of political considerations, or as independent as you can make it. And but you also have academia. You have all of these different institutions that all sort of get to have their say, and through which individuals get to have their say, and the voters ultimately get to vote on all of this. And that's why it's legitimate. It provides the framework within which we can move society forward, tethered to these basic principles and this basic text, but not tethered to them so tightly that we have to look only at what they did in 1787 to figure out what they mean.
And I'm glad that you raised this point, Ed, because it really, to me, is one of the most eloquent things about Balkan's idea here. This is not simply about us rooting around in the bushes for some constitutional textual meaning that we can pluck out and apply to a given set of facts. This is about the very notions of legitimacy. It's about what makes the Constitution, and why it is that it's so important to us as a society. It's about legitimacy and how we make sure through our participatory democracy that that legitimacy remains a real thing. And that's one of the reasons, for those of you following along at home, why Ed and I get so worked up about what Trump and the GOP are doing to the electoral system with gerrymandering and vote suppression and all that. They're not simply tinkering with outcomes. They are messing with participatory democracy, and thus they are screwing around with the legitimacy of the system itself.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And so the thing that this always reminds me of, a constitutional interpretation, I've written about this a few times. The thing that it always reminds me of is biblical interpretation.
Of course.
The analogs are so obvious to me.
Yes.
Between originalism and, you know, legal formalism and legal realism and conservative and liberal biblical interpretation, literalism.
Yep. Yeah.
As I said
at the top, it's all about textual understanding and interpretation. And it doesn't matter what text we're talking about. It doesn't matter whether you're talking about the Bible or the Constitution or a set of vacuum cleaner assembly instructions.
But
it's all about textual interpretation.
Religion being powerful as it is in our society, it's fascinating that they track so closely.
Sure. Right.
Onto these political Venn diagrams, you know, and I remember the reason why Balkin appealed to me, this text and principles approach, was that for the first time when I was introduced to his ideas, I realized that there's different types of texts in the Constitution. Now it seems so obvious. I mean, the moment you read it, you go, well, of course there are.
Right.
But at the time, this had somehow escaped me that, you know, you mentioned earlier that you have the text of you have to be 35 years old to be president. You can't abstract that. It doesn't say you have to have reached an age of maturity.
Correct.
This is absolutely simple. A 5-year-old can interpret it. You don't need to go any further than that.
It's a formally realizable rule, one that's easy to understand and easy to administer. You want to be the president, you got to be 35.
Right. But what does it mean when you say you can't adopt, Congress can't enact a law restricting freedom of speech or freedom of the press?
Right.
What does that mean?
Correct.
And now we're into a higher level of thinking. Now we're into abstraction.
That's right.
And it reminds me very much of something that happened to me back 25 years ago when I first started going online and getting involved in religious discussions. And there's a man named Henry Neufeld, who I still talk to, still a friend, who was a Methodist minister, biblical scholar, Hebrew scholar in particular, was his specialty. And we used to, not he and I so much, but others, I would get into arguments with fundamentalists, biblical literalists, you know, in which I would point out, you know, there's these contradictions in the Bible. You know, this verse says this and this verse says that. And Henry's response would be, yeah, that's contradiction. I go, wait a minute, you're a Christian. You just admitted there's a contradiction in the Bible. He's like, well, yeah, but I'm not a biblical literalist. And he was the one who first pointed out to me, just like Balkin was the one who first pointed out to me, not individually, that there's different types of texts in the Bible, too.
Sure.
It's a collection of 60-some books written by different people over hundreds and hundreds of years. Some of it is poetry. Some of it is music. Some of it was intended to be literal history. Some of it is clearly allegory. In the book of Isaiah, when it says the mountains sang and the trees clapped, the most literalist doesn't think that trees actually clapped and mountains actually sang. You can recognize in that this is a different type of text than when it says, we went to war with Midian and killed X number of people, you know.
Sure.
There's different types of text, and you have to approach them in different ways and interpret them in different ways. And it's, again, it's one of those things where, like, once you're introduced to it, it seems gobsmackingly obvious. Like, how did I not recognize that all this time? But, like I said, the analogs between these two things are just so remarkably in tune with one another. And the fact that those different ways of interpreting the Bible and different ways of interpreting the Constitution map almost perfectly onto conservative and liberal in our political discourse. That's not a coincidence. It's because that's the way they think about things. They want everything to be literal. They want everything to be simple. They don't like nuance. They don't like having to deal with abstraction. This is what they want is the Ten Commandments. They want a set of rules. Do that. You can do this. You can't do that. End of discussion. Well, society doesn't really work that way, you know, outside of criminal law, you know, where we're going to be very specific. When it comes to these questions of how do you treat other people, what are your rights, individual rights, these are matters of enormous and important debate. And that's why I find so compelling this idea that the Constitution, and the reason it's legitimate is because it provides this very good framework within which we can have these arguments and avoid both extremes. The extreme of we can only do what they did in 1787 versus the text is totally irrelevant. We can do whatever the hell we want. Whatever a judge says is what's true that day. You know, there's got to be something in between there. And there is. And I think as a general rule, as frustrating as it can be for those of us who are activists and advocates of progressive change, that it moves so slowly. As a general rule, I think that framework has served us pretty well in advancing the causes of equality and justice and fairness.
Hours and hours of fun for the whole family, Ed.
Anyway, that was. I hope that our listeners found that conversation as fascinating as you and I do, because this is what gets me grooving. You know, I love this.
Yeah, I know it.
This topic.
It's fun stuff. It's fascinating stuff. It really is.
Yeah, and I hope that we've helped people understand better the various ideas of originalism, because there isn't just one, and why there's some legitimacy to the core of it, while it's being a big con job as practiced by Republicans and conservatives today. We certainly agree on that. So I hope we've done a good job of educating people on that. We will be back next week, and I'm sure we're going to want to talk a lot in the next 2 weeks about these confirmation hearings and about Judge Kavanaugh's record, which strikes me as, you know what, he's going to be exactly what any Republican president would have nominated.
That's correct. He is a bog standard Republican Supreme Court nominee in this day and age, which is a scary thing, but it is what it is.
He might as well have been built in a laboratory.
He was built in the Federalist Society Article 3 Judge Lab. Did you hear about that?
Essentially.
They've got a set of instructions. It starts at birth.
Yes. So anyway, we will see you next week again on Culture Wars Radio. Thanks for listening.
Thanks, everybody.
Of white bread foundation. We're taping our king beating off his crown. My country tears on the sweet land of irony, spoonful of sugar to wash it.